Hello, Grace Community Church. My name is Seth Rumsey. I'm one of the pastors here at Grace, and I want to welcome you to week three of our virtual worship time together. And who would have thought we would be filming from home and piecing this together, but that's what God's given us, and we're going to celebrate that. And I want to talk about that for a moment because I think we just need a quick reminder of what this is. That it's not a program, it's not an event, and it's not necessarily even an experience. This is worship. This is worship of Jesus, our God, our King, and our Savior. And I know we're scattered all over Central Maryland, but we're together around the praises of our King. And so let's just take a moment to remember that. To bring our hearts and our minds and our souls ready to receive whatever it is that God would have for us today. So with that, church, let's enter into the worship of Jesus together.
Let's sing together these words to remind ourselves that God's worthy of our worship in every circumstance. Let's sing, Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Worship your holy name.
The sun
comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. And bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship His holy name. And sing like never before. O my soul. Worship your holy name.
He's rich in love.
You're rich in love, and you're slow to anger. Your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
It's a blessing.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name.
And on that day,
and on that day, when my strength is failing, the end draws near. And my time is come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. worship His holy name and sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name.
I will worship
Your holy name.
Yes, I will.
I will worship Your holy
name. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven You came running. There was mercy in Your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. King of Kings.
me is worthy of your praise.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, King Jesus. We live for you. Holy, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Beside you, open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your love and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. Yeah. trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Well, church, as things continue to evolve, and we receive more updates with the situation that we're facing, we want to keep you up to speed. And so please check out our online resources at grace.community/virtual or follow us on our various social media accounts. But we want to continue to offer ways that you can engage with each other virtually, whether it's through prayer, connecting with a community group virtually. We want to allow the space and that opportunity to be encouraged. And maybe now more than ever, we need that. We need other believers to speak into our life and to remind us that God is God and that He is good and that He is in control and that we can trust Him. We need that prayer. We need that support. We need that encouragement. So enter in whatever way you can, and continue to follow what Grace is doing for each other as we connect virtually across Central Maryland to keep connected to God's Word and prayer and with one another. We also want to continue our time of worship through our offering. We want to recognize that God is a generous giver, and He continues to supply us with everything we need, even in the midst of difficult times. Maybe especially in the midst of difficult times, we can remember that all things are from His hand. And as the people of God, we can respond by giving generously in return, even sacrificially, because that's what God has done for us through Christ. So there are several ways you can give. You can go online to give, you can text to give, and you can also mail your checks into the church office. So we want to thank you for your generosity. We want to praise God and ask for His blessing over our gifts, and that they would bless our church and the community around and meet many needs in this trying time. So let's continue our worship through our offering. It's my privilege to lead us now in our community prayer. And today and for the remainder of the week, we're going to be praying for our medical personnel and first responders. Church, these are those that are on the front lines battling this global health crisis. Our nurses, our doctors, our EMTs, our firefighters, our police officers, our medical technicians, those that are in the lab. They are on the front lines working hard, diligently, day after day, hour after hour, to try and find a cure and to keep people healthy. And just as boldly as they are working. We want to pray boldly for them and therefore their protection. I know many of you are in that field. I know many of you have family members going to the hospitals or on the front lines every day. I know many of my neighbors going to the hospitals on a regular basis to fight for a cure and to keep people healthy and alive. So let's pray for them. There'll be some prayer prompts on the screen that you can follow along with. We ask that you would pray out loud, boldly, with those that you are with, your family members, your roommates, and let's lift up our workers, our medical personnel, to the Lord now. And after a few moments, I will say a closing prayer. Lord God and our Heavenly Father, we want to bring before you today our medical personnel, Lord, those that are fighting to find a cure and to keep people healthy and alive, that are in the hospitals, that are in the ambulances, that are creating the stand-up medical facilities, that are fighting hard to find a cure. God, we want to lift them up to you now. We want to pray for their protection. Keep them healthy so that they can continue to fight to keep others healthy. God, protect them in that way. God, give them strength and endurance, as I know they're working long and hard hours. God, strengthen them. Even now, strengthen them so they can continue their work and move forward in what they are doing to help protect us and keep us safe. God, I pray for their family members, that you would keep them healthy, that you would protect them from this virus. I pray that you would protect their hearts from worry and anxiety and fear, that you would give them your peace that surpasses understanding as they watch their loved ones each and every day go to the front lines. God, we want to thank you for those who are engaging in this way, that are serving in this way, that are sacrificing in this way, God. If they're serving and blessing our nation and our world. And so, God, we boldly ask, God, that you would protect, that you would uphold, that you would guard. God, that even supernaturally, God, you would give those who are working for a cure the knowledge and the ability to find the right solutions to bring an end to this pandemic. God, would you do this in your mercy, by your power, and by your hand, and in your time, and for your glory. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, church, for praying. May you have a blessed week in the Lord. And may you experience the peace and the love of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, Grace Community Church. What a joy to worship with you today. As you can tell from my surroundings, we're in a slightly different location shooting this message. As our world continues to change and the situation continues to unfold, we're finding ourselves needing to adapt to more and more restrictive measures of our comings and goings. And it's really forcing us to ask the question, what does it mean to be the church? And that's what I want to talk to you about over these next two Sundays, an opportunity to be reminded from God's word about what the essence of the church is. Sometimes we can get into thinking that the church is a building, a place that we go to or attend. But rather, in the scriptures, the church has always been an organism, a nimble, flexible, adaptable, a group of disciples who are following Jesus, and they ultimately go on to change the world. In the field of chaos theory, there's this idea called an adaptive challenge. And what an adaptive challenge is, it's a set of factors, an environment that comes upon an organism or an organization that basically says adapt or die. These new sets of challenges cause an organization to rethink itself, to get back to the mission for which it exists, its very basic foundations. And it also brings the opportunity for new innovation, new ways of being and carrying out its mission. That's what I believe that this season brings to us as an opportunity to rethink, reimagine, to get back to the roots of what it means to be a church. Just a few weeks ago, a church reached out to us, and they needed help setting up their online giving, because in this environment where we can't meet together, they would either have to adapt to an online giving thing or die. These are the kinds of adaptive challenges that are facing every organization, but also the church. It's been so neat. I don't know if you've caught it on Facebook Live or on various social media outlets. You've just seen over and over just tons of churches and pastors like myself broadcasting messages, figuring out ways to meet, connect, to follow Jesus digitally. Those are the adaptive challenges of our day. Because here's what happens. If for any organism to exist, any organization to exist, it needs structures. And those structures exist to support their systems that are in place to help that organism or that organization function. But as the organization grows or as other outside factors come in upon it, those structures are put to the test. And eventually, those structures actually begin to restrict the growth and the adaptability of the organism or organization. Those structures have to be shed and new ones have to be brought in order for that organism or organization to continue to survive. If you're a Marylander, you know that this is what happens every spring for the blue crab. The Maryland blue crab, as it grows, it must shed its exoskeleton and then become a soft shell while the salt water hardens the shell until it grows out of that one and it needs to be shed again. If a crab does not shed its shell, it will die. This, I believe, is the opportunity we have. And we're trying. We're figuring out new ways to connect with each other, to worship together, to pray together. And all of it is making us go back to say, what are the absolute essentials of what it means to be the church? Well, today, I want to take you to a blueprint, a picture, an early picture of the church immediately after Jesus ascends and the Holy Spirit comes down, what the DNA of that church was. What were the essential practices of what it meant to be a church? We're going to go to a very familiar passage in Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. And this passage is just a little summary snapshot. There's actually several of them in Acts 4 and Acts 5. But this one in Acts 2 follows on the heels of one of the greatest sermons ever preached by Peter on the southern steps of the temple. Peter preaches to a gathered group of Jews from all over the world who've come together, and they're wondering what is going on with these followers of Jesus. The Spirit comes upon them. They start speaking in the languages of every single person there, and they assume that these men are drunk. And Peter stands up and he says, "We're not drunk. Actually, what's happened is the fulfillment of God's prophecy." And then he goes on to explain in one comprehensive detail the nature, the work, the person of what and who Jesus the Christ was and is. And people respond. They say, what do we have to do to be saved? Peter says, repent, turn from your sin, and believe this message and be saved. And so the people respond, and then a movement is born. Let's read this together in Acts 2, 42 to 47. In fact, I want you to pause the video right now and read this out loud again. If you're with people, take turns, maybe alternate each verse and read it aloud. And imagine yourself in the story. So what did we read? What pictures of the early church, the essence of the nimble, flexible, organic church did you see? Let me just highlight a couple of things here. The first, did you notice in verse 22, they devoted themselves. This is the verb of this whole section, devoted. They were devoted to various things, teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, prayers. This word in the Greek means the idea of committing yourself to, re-upping, recommitting yourself to. It's not the idea of mastery as much as it's the idea of coming back to something over and over again. In fact, it appears in the book of Acts 6 times as to describe the sort of return, the recommitment, the continual learning that the early church committed themselves to. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. What does that mean? Why the apostles' teaching? Well, the apostles' teaching was unfolding the story of Scripture and reminding the church of its origin stories. Do you like origin stories? The Marvel movie franchise has really cornered the market on this. And now I think we're going to see a wave, even in the Star Wars franchise, of origin stories. Where did people come from? How did they come about? How did they become who they are as we know them? Well, the church has an origin story. In fact, all of us live by the stories that form us. I am the son of immigrants who immigrated to the United States in 1974. My parents gave up so much for my sister and myself to be able to have a life here, to have an impact, to make something of the world. That is an important part of my origin story, and it defines me, it forms who I am, but it's not the most important story. Actually, there's a greater story. There's the story of a God who created Mitchell Lee in his image that I might become more and more like his son. But Mitchell Lee rebelled against God. I was self-righteous. I thought that I could make my approval based on what I could do or earn and how well I could achieve. And God sent his son, Jesus, to die for a rebel, an enemy like me. And by giving up his life on the cross, he paid the price for my rebellion and invites me to come into a relationship with him. And if I, and as I surrender to what Jesus has done for me, that I could not do it for myself, God promises his Spirit to fill me in order to make me more like the image of his son. That is the most important story. Listen, Grace Community Church, we are formed by that story. In fact, that story is more than just an individual. That story is the reason why you're even watching this video right now. There is a connection, there's a unity, there's a bond and a kindredness that you and I have in Jesus, the story that forms us, the story that transcends socioeconomic boundaries, the story that transcends ethnic and racial distinctions, the story that transcends your past and your present, the story that knits us together and says, we all needed saving and Jesus is a good Savior. That's the story that the church was constantly devoted to. They were devoted to the apostles' teaching because the teaching would remind them of the story that forms them. Listen, it is hard work to stay committed to the story, to be committed to the story that forms us above all other stories, because you see, our world offers constant stories as to what will give us happiness, what will give us approval, what will give us purpose, all sorts of stories. Go out and achieve more, earn more, find your approval by how well you can appear on the outside. All of those stories compete for our loyalty, our energy, our attention. And so we have to be constantly reminded as a church of the story that trumps all the other stories. The early church was devoted to the apostles' teaching. That's not just to that, though. Keep reading with me. The early church was devoted to the fellowship. Fellowship. What is fellowship? It has the idea of participation, a community, a life-on-life belonging to one another. They were committed to this. Because the story that formed them and brought them together, they now said, we belong to each other. Before Christ, we may have been strangers. Now that we have met Christ, we are family. They were committed to this partnership, this community of belonging to one another. And that makes all the difference, especially in a world that is separated by so much division, fear. This is a time to be reminded, to be devoted to the fellowship, our partnership together. Keep reading with me, not just to the fellowship, but also to the breaking of bread. The breaking of bread. Now that, in this context, I think has more to do with eating it has more to do with something else than just eating. If you notice the rest of these, the teaching, fellowship, prayers, these all have to do with the church's spiritual life. It has to do with their devotion to the story, to Christ, their worship before God. So what does breaking of bread here mean? Breaking of bread here probably has to do with the idea that the church was devoted to remembering Christ, remembering what Christ had done for them. So not only were they devoted to the apostles' teaching, but they were devoted to remembering Jesus in the way that Jesus commanded them to remember him. That on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. He says, every time you eat this, remember that I gave my life for you. My sacrifice is what brings you and forms you together. That's what the church was devoted to. They were devoted to the gospel message that Christ crucified was everything that they needed. So they devoted themselves to the breaking of bread, and they devoted themselves to prayers, continuing to pray together, communing with God, speaking to God, and being spoken to by him. They were committed to the prayers. If we put all this together, we get a simple formula for what it means to be the early church. Devotion. Devotion to teaching, devotion to life on life, devotion to remembrance, and devotion to prayer. But lest you think that the early church, that their DNA was just simply some private, quiet devotion, there was also action that was a part of what it meant to be the church. Keep reading with me here in verse 43. And awe came upon every soul. That was the result. Awe. Literally a reverent fear. Like, have you ever been in awe when you see something happen among a group of people and you're just like, wow, what was that? Maybe students, have you ever been at a retreat on that last night when there's this worship gathering and a move of God and you're just seeing people respond to God like you've never seen before? You're just in awe. Even in lesser ways, have you ever just sat in an incredible concert or heard a thing of music and it just felt otherworldly and you were just in awe? I wonder if that's what's going on here, as people are seeing and experiencing this kind of life together being formed, signs and wonders being done. There's an awe that fills them, and they were together. They had everything in common, and that commonness led to different action. Look at the actions. Verse 45. They were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. Radical generosity was going on in the early church. And lest you think that this was a church overflowing with things, no, like this was a church that believed so much that they belonged to each other that it was their responsibility to care for one another, to meet one another's needs. I want to contrast that spirit with the spirit of the world that we're in right now. I mean, we're in a world when our backs are pressed against the wall, it really is a survive or die mentality, isn't it? I mean, it's why grocery stores and hardware stores have to put a limit on the milk you can buy, or number of eggs you can buy, or water, or toilet paper, or sanitizer, because they know that in our base nature, we work out of a scarcity mindset. And it's not about wanting to stick it to the next person, it's just survival, right? I mean, all of this really comes out of a fear of what if. Like, what if I don't get enough right now? Will I have enough for tomorrow? It's that fear that drives us. And actually, if you look right below that fear, there's actually a kind of underlying competition. Because it's not just a fear of running out, it's a fear of what if somebody takes it and there's nothing left for me? That's why we find ourselves even unknowingly, unintentionally hoarding, is that we think somebody else is going to get it, so I better. It's why in a grocery store, when somebody starts loading up their cart, everyone starts wondering, should I get more? Should I grab more? Did I do enough? That's not the mentality of the church. The church is, we care for one another. In fact, I'll actually do with less so that somebody, one of my brothers and sisters, can do with more. It is a radical time for generosity. It's a radical time to really put our money where our mouth is. When we pray, God, give us our daily bread. Because you see, look, if we can fortify ourselves and stock up for next week, you know what? We won't need God until next week. But the early church, they cared for each other. Radical generosity. Keep looking. Verse 46, day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts. This is the hardest part right now, isn't it, to be the church? With each week that passes, with just seeing you guys on social media or connecting virtually, it just makes my heart beat a little bit faster for the time when we can come together. We're not able to do this in its full expression, but oh my, this time makes us see how beautiful and what a privilege it is. This church, the early church, was coming together in the temple. They were gathering together every day. They saw each other, their paths cross. And not only that, but not only did they gather together, but then they split up and they went to each other's homes and they ate. They ate incredible meals. Let me just describe this, maybe to stir our longing for the time when we can do this, that what a privilege it is to come together. I mean, in fact, not coming together really puts some things in perspective, doesn't it? When we are, the things that we might complain about in our gatherings together, the things that we might want more of or less of, our preferences when it comes together, those seem very inconsequential, insignificant now that we can't meet. Gosh, just to come together is a privilege. I pray that one day we will be able to. But for now, this will have to do. Or how about eating together? What a privilege it is to have table fellowship, to gather in one another's homes around a meal, to break bread, and to remember God's goodness to us. Because look at what they do. They come together and they receive their food with glad and generous hearts. Glad and generous hearts. Meaning there's plenty to go around when they eat. There's a good meal. It's a good time. I once heard it said that when you get good food plus good people, that's what makes a great meal. That was an essence and part of the church. Aren't you glad? I'm so glad that eating together and being together was part of what made church life so powerful and beautiful. And in fact, the consequence of this, so if we just look at this, we put this together, we get a formula for what it meant to be the early church. What it means, not even the early church, let me say it this way, what it means to be the church. Devotion plus action. Devotion to the teaching, life on life, remembrance and prayers, plus action. Generosity, gathering together, eating together. This is the simple formula to be the church. And do you know what the consequence is? You know what the result is? That people praise God. And look at this. Look at it in verse 47. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who are being saved. The community grew. because people were attracted to that. They were attracted to the otherworldliness of being devoted to a story that was better than any story that had been given to them. They were attracted to the radical generosity and the sense of belonging. They were attracted to the eating together and the graciousness and the sharing of food together. They were attracted to these things. What happens? This is our cultural moment, church. This is an opportunity to go from what we often talk about, community, to the sense of communitas. What is communitas? The communitas is the gravity of belonging to one another. And here's how communitas is formed. A community is just people who come together. You might have a community in your neighborhood. You may or may not participate in it, but you're part of it. You're part of this community. But communitas happens when you're thrust into a space that's uncertain, maybe even a bit dangerous, and you have to bond together for the sake of survival. You have to find one another for the sake of continuing on. That's communitas, that urgent sense of believing or belonging. It's what happens when you show up in a new environment. You look immediately for people that you know. Or your first day in the job, you find this bond with somebody who actually welcomes you, a bond with maybe another new person. Or when you go to a first-time training and you're there with a whole bunch of people who are going through the same training, there's a sense of bonding that happens. We need to stick together to survive. It's why if you go into a college campus, you can always tell where the freshmen are because they move around in packs. While in the dining halls, the upperclassmen are the ones who've already figured out their routine. They've already know how to operate. And so they're more individual. They kind of come and go. This is what communitas is. And I believe that God is giving us a moment as a church now to return to a sense of communitas. What do you do when you're cut off? Where do you go? Like I said last week, the idea of longings. Could this be our moment as a church to return back to the simple DNA of being a communitas, the gravity that says we belong to one another? So here's the formula again. Devotion plus action. How can we live this out now in our quarantine wilderness? Justin Early wrote a book called The Common Rule. I know that you've heard me mention it, referenced to it several times. And he put out something really helpful a few weeks ago about living out your spiritual, carrying out your spiritual formation while under quarantine. And I want to take that and I want to apply that to the ways that the church was devoted. So let's just think through this together. Being devoted to the teaching. A couple things I want you to consider in your isolation, in your quarantine. First, you've heard me say it before, scripture before phone. Even just this morning, getting up, I'm turning her over, and I have this urge to go check my phone. I want to go check Slack to see what the latest things are in the staff. I want to check social media to see what the latest decrees are and the news outlets. Like, I have this desire to jump into and find out what I missed while I was sleeping. I put that down, and for some reason, even because I was thinking about this message, I was like, you know, scripture before phone. So I read Psalm 47. Psalm 47, just a short psalm. Great is the Lord, most worthy to be praised, in the city of our God, the holy place. And just being reminded that God is a fortress again. It was a great way to start, to be formed, to be devoted to the greater story that God is a fortress. Scripture before phone. If you're not in a daily reading plan right now, join me. I'm in the book of Acts right now, and I'm a little bit further in Acts, but I'm going to start again. I'm going to go with Acts 3 starting tomorrow and just read a chapter each day in the book of Acts. Read a chapter, imagine what it was like, and simply ask, what is God telling me and what must I do? That's simple, a reading plan. So join with me starting tomorrow, Acts reading plan, Acts chapter 3. Here's another one. If you want to be formed and devoted to the teaching, to the story that forms you, limit your the checking of news and social media to 3 times a day. 3 times a day, I dare you. There's the challenge. Maybe morning, maybe midday, maybe afternoon. 3 times a day. Don't constantly go back to find out because that story will form you. So be devoted to the teaching. How can we be devoted to Life on Life? Use FaceTime, not just text, but use FaceTime. Call, look at each other, and just check up on each other. You might want to use Zoom to do this, but check up on each other. Don't need anything else, no other agenda. Hey, just wanted to hear your voice, see your face, see how you're doing. Everybody needs to be able to express what you're feeling, maybe naming some fears, uncertainties, praying for one another. Let's be devoted to life on life, even digitally for the time being. Being devoted to prayer. I love this. Pray as you wash your hands. 20 seconds. You can pray for a neighbor in 20 seconds. You can pray for a leader. You can pray for a frontline, a medical worker. You can pray for somebody who's lost their job. You can pray for your family members. You can pray for for seniors, the elderly, the immunocompromised. Pray as you wash your hands. And I hope you're washing your hands many times during the day. Pray, 20 seconds. Pray for someone. Prayer calls. Go to grace.community/virtual. You'll see we've got prayer calls happening just about 3 times a day, all day long, every day of the week. Join us. A Facebook Live prayer gathering on Wednesday night, 7 p.m. I'll be leading that. Come on. And comment. We want to engage in prayer together. If you want some more resources about this, like I said, Justin Early put out this little document, and it's a great, even 3 times short, morning, midday, evening prayer. There's a prayer you can do with your children. There's the 20-second prayer for hand washing. I mean, there's just a number of ways to do this. How about the action part? Church, continue to be generous. Don't be fearful. Listen, I know it's fearful times. We don't know the stock market's going up and down. I know all of the unemployment, all these things, the economy is in dire straits right now. We have to meet each other's needs. God is calling us to be the church. If we fold and go down in fear, it will show who our God really is. So continue to be generous and continue to meet needs. You know, at the church, we're collecting food and meals, and then we're sanitizing it, and then we're delivering it to people who are shut in, seniors, people who can't go out, meet needs. Many of you have volunteered to give rides and to be the hands and feet of Jesus at a time like this. We're going to continue to be generous in our actions. And finally, we're going to devote ourselves to connecting. Every weekend, look, gang, we're going to continue to do messages like this. We're going to sing together. We are committed to continuing to worship together as a church. I hope that you'll join us. And in your home, take the time to eat together. Roommates, if you're all alone, get on FaceTime during a meal, right? Get somebody else on FaceTime and eat together, even if it's digitally. Have some conversations over food. Don't just grab your food and run to your own rooms or your own space or your own screens, but take the time to eat a meal together. This is a God-ordained time for us. So here's the formula again: devotion and action. That's what it meant to be the early church. And I believe that this is a moment for us, church, to come back to the DNA of who God has made us to be and called us to be as the church. It was never about a building. It was never about a campus. The church does not need a zip code to come together. Rather, the church was the church when the people of God came together for the purpose of sitting under teaching, being reminded of the story, life on life, of remembering who Jesus is and was, of praying together, of being radically generous to care for one another's needs, of eating together, being in one another's presence. Like, this is what it means to be the church. And this is our adaptive challenge. This is our challenge today. Is church for you just a once a week, 1 hour, plug in, and then go on with your own life? Because I tell you, that's not the biblical definition of the church. The church is the called out ones, the disciples of Jesus, who have come under and are coming under the lordship of Jesus, saying, Jesus, you do what you want to do in our lives and through our lives. Our lives belong to you. This is our moment. This is our moment to be the church, to come back to our original DNA. And maybe, who knows, God will innovate some things that we'll never go back to. Even when the coronavirus, Lord willing, is well behind us, that we will be led into and introduced to new ways of being the church, not just for our sake, but for the sake of our world and for the glory of God. This mission will go forward. God's gospel is going to go forward, be proclaimed to the ends of the earth. And I pray that as we adapt and as we go back to the basics of what it means to be the church, that even this week, you'll experience the power of God's Spirit among us as we continue to be the church. God bless you guys. Love you. Praying for you.
Into dark created by your word came the light, the heavens and the earth. God alone simply spoke the oceans and the stars. May my soul remember who you are. Know my soul, He is in control, Maker and friend, love without end on His throne. Is holding on to me. How can I deny it? But oh, how can it be? The one who holds the heavens is holding on to me. Though darkness may on His throne.
So church, as we continue our scattered existence this week, I pray that God would give you grace to be devoted to the teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayers, and that he would lead you and give you courage and conviction to be radically generous to meet the needs around you, as well as to continue to figure out ways to gather together over screens and eating together with those in your home. May God bless you. May you feel his presence ever nearer to you as we continue to be the church, both for God's glory and for the sake of our world. Go in peace and wash your hands.